welcome to Around Town, the show that provides information on North Andover and the surrounding towns in the Merrimack Valley. I'm your host, Jim Fazio, and I'm here today with my guest, Dr. Susan Smith, who is on the Poet Laureate Search Committee for Andover, Karen Kline, the former Poet Laureate of North Andover, and Helena Minton, who is on the Poet Laureate Search Committee here in North Andover. Happy New Year, ladies.
Happy New Year to you, too.
And what are we going to talk about today?
Well, we have a lot of things we can talk about with poetry. I am very dear friends of these two people who are, as you said, from search committees in the two towns. And in 2005, I decided to ask the selectmen in North Andover to appoint a poet laureate. And they didn't understand what I wanted to have, and very few people understood what it was about. Many people say, what is that?
I didn't know what it was.
I know. You aren't alone. You are not alone. A poet laureate is a person who can be paid an honorarium or can be done for no charge at all. And most of the poets laureate probably don't get a salary at all. They might get a payment from a school or a library to do a program, but they do not get a paid position from the group that puts them in the position. So in 2005, the town said, yes, let's try it. So we had a Poet Laureate Search Committee, and Blair Woodman was the one person. I have to mention her name. She was a lovely lady. She just passed away in November, and she was the guiding force along with me. She used to live in Andover, and now she lived in North Andover when we did this in 2005, but she knew everybody who had anything to do with poetry. And Haverhill, she was involved with Haverhill poetry, so the two of us really did a lot of the work together. And we ended up with February of 2006, we had the first poet laureate in position. And the poet laureates have a two-year term in North Andover. Every town is different. And we had the people, each poet laureate has been in for 4 years since Gail Henney. She was from, she had a four-year term, and then I had a four-year term. And now we have two new poets laureate who are a husband and wife team.
Oh, that's different, huh?
It's very different. We never thought we'd have two at once.
Really? Yeah.
And they are a husband and wife team. Nadine is a dancer. She's a ballet instructor and an actress. And Ken is an actor.
Really?
And they also love poetry.
Well, you also, one time, you described what a poet laureate was by definition, your definition, and you called the poet laureate a cheerleader for poetry, and I thought that was, that sounds great.
It is. It's great. Absolutely what you're supposed to be. You have to be in love with it.
Really,
And even, I don't know how demanding it is to have a perfect person to write as far as their creation of poetry, because everybody has a different value to certain types of poetry. There is such a subjective view of, do you like this one?
Right.
Yes, I love it. Oh, I don't. I mean, you know, it's like any movie, anything that's created. If you see a car, you see a car. And with a poem, it's not the same thing at all. It just isn't.
That's right.
And then you also want to hear the motivation for writing the poem. That is so important. Where did it come from? I love to hear the backstory. But
And how it's presented, too.
Very, very important. Because sometimes I can't write, I cannot read my own poetry. I have passed it on to so many people in the past because I just can't read it myself. I wrote this afternoon, just, I read a book, I mean, a line from Maya Angelou, who was just a magnificent, magnificent woman who wrote poetry that was just unbelievably moving. And she was the poet invited to President Clinton's first inaugural in 1992. And she read And Still I Rise. That was the poem she read. But she wrote here, spirit is an invisible force made visible in all of life. And it's through poetry, through writing, that it's made visible. Mm-hmm. And you feel, when you go to a funeral, when you go to a wedding, when you have a birth, you hear poetry.
Right, I never thought of it that
way. It's always really? At the most important points mm-hmm. of our life.
Really?
And that's why people don't remember it. It's always there. But one person who absolutely was a magnificent lover of poetry because of his mother was Ted Kennedy. Yeah.
Wow.
Ted was the youngest. Bobby, I have the book here for Bobby Kennedy, but the whole Kennedy family was just in love with poetry.
Really?
And it was mainly because of Rose. Mm-hmm. Rose brought poetry into every dinner. Each child had to memorize a new poem for dinner every night.
Wow.
And you never knew who was going to be picked. So Teddy was the youngest, so he had the most of that. So he was the one who just, I'll never forget when the six firemen were killed in Worcester,
uh-huh.
in the big fire there mm-hmm. in December, I think it was 96,
I'm not sure. Yeah.
He read the most beautiful, eloquent poetry that he wrote himself for the elegy. Yes,
that was just amazing.
Very nice. It was an amazing event.
Wow.
Yeah, he did a great job. He loved poetry, and it was part of him. So, and I never got to it until 1995.
Oh.
You got to it a lot through.
Way late from here.
Person who.
The first poet from America, the first poet who was ever published from America, founded our town, which was then one town of Andover,
mm-hmm.
and it was Ann Dudley Bradstreet. And her poems speak to me. They're natural. She talks about crickets and grasshoppers and sunsets and oak trees, and being tripped up by the briars when you're walking. When she's walking on uneven ground because that's what she was living in. 1646, 1647, 1648. There was nothing here.
And then her children, she wrote
about so much about her children. And her mm-hmm. husband traveling back and forth to England from America.
Mm-hmm.
People still had business trips. Even in 1640s, 1650s,
really?
They
then.
Went back to England.
Huh.
And then come back, they would do it several times. And she was missing him terribly when he was gone. And she had 8 children. I'd miss him too if I had 8 children. I didn't
really?
Have him around to help me.
She'd write at night.
Yes, she wrote at night when everybody was asleep. How she ever got, and she wrote more pages than anyone in the 17th century.
Wow.
More pages, and they were by firelight, and I don't even know where she got the paper.
Well, there was a shortage that she didn't, I think drafts were hard to, because she had a shortage of paper.
Yes, she had
didn't she write on vellum?
She wrote on everything she could think of, she could find, and then they had a fire.
Right.
So how many of the pages were lost in the fire? We have no idea. July 10th, 1666.
Wow.
The house burned down. So she had to have lost pages. She had to have lost pages.
She must have.
Yep.
Definitely.
But she had her home, we think, across the street from the Parson Barnard House on Osgood Street.
Wow.
Right at Academy Road.
Right. I know that.
Yep.
Yeah.
They found burned wood, a pipe, pieces of pottery, and they dated it to that time frame, and it's directly across from the Parson Barnard House on that land.
Now you're talking about Bradstreet, right?
Yes, Ann Bradstreet right. was from now, there. That's where her home was.
Did they name the school after her?
They named it after her husband.
Okay.
Here we go again.
All right.
With it being, everybody thought it was named for her
because right.
it was a kindergarten.
Right.
But no, it was named, and there's Bradstreet Road
right.
near
yep.
the library.
Yep. Right.
And no, they were named mainly for him. So that's another part to my work.
Okay.
We've talked about wanting to have a trail in
exactly.
town named after her.
We really do
Dudley
want
a trail.
Yeah, trail, yes.
Because they said Bradstreet's too confusing for the name of a trail.
Right.
Because where's the street?
The street.
What street?
Right, exactly.
Oh. So let's do it. Okay, let's honor her maiden name, Anne Dudley.
Oh, yeah.
She came over here in 1630 with her father, her mother, all of her family. Her husband landed in Salem, stayed there for a very short time because everybody in the Salem village was sick. Governor Endicott, they were all pathetically sick because they were starving to death. So they moved right down to Charlestown. And they stayed in Charlestown for a very short time, and then they moved down to and founded Boston.
Hmm.
at the foot of Prince Street. Governor Winthrop and Simon Bradstreet, Thomas Dudley, and the ladies, you know, Anne Bradstreet, her mother Dorothy, and her sisters and her brother, and I believe her brother-in-law, Reverend Woodbridge, was still with them, was with them then. And after they had stayed there for a short time, Thomas Dudley, her father, decided, you know what, let's go over across the other river. They went over the Mystic to get to from Charlestown to Boston. Then they went over the Charles, and they founded Anne Dudley and her father and mother and husband, Simon Bradstreet, founded Cambridge.
Oh, wow.
December 28th, 1630, they founded Cambridge.
Wow, there's a lot of history in poetry.
Oh, there is. There
is. A lot of history.
That's what
I mean,
is
just not poetry, but no. I mean, history itself.
Mm-hmm. Of
that's
every
incredible.
Every town has this story. That's why I want Poets Laureate.
And that's what
in
you're trying
every
to,
town.
You're trying to achieve this mm-hmm. goal of having it in Lawrence. One
yep.
just happened in Andover.
Right. And Susan's here to mm-hmm. explain
that's
that
right.
one.
Yes. Yeah. And you're trying to put more around the
of
state
course.
Of Massachusetts.
And we'd
which
like
would
the
be
whole
a really nice
state.
Thing.
We'd like
we'd
the
like
state.
The whole state. It's
right.
one of the only states in the country that does not
does
have its
not
own
have a Poet Laureate.
Poet Laureate. You can
that's
go
a shame.
Online and see almost every other
every
state.
Other state.
You would think Massachusetts would have it.
Would have been the first.
Right.
With all the history and
it
the
have been
in
literature
like
and all the
1700s.
Really?
There is
yes.
one in Boston.
Oh, yes, there is one. Sam Cornish right. used to be the Poet Laureate in Boston, uh-huh. the city. And then he retired after, I think, 10 years.
Now it's Danielle LeGros George.
Right.
And Somerville has a new Poet Laureate,
yep.
Gloria Mindock. She
right.
Was
she was
appointed.
Just put in position. Yeah. And, there, and Arlington has one. You used the Arlington Poet Laureate Selection Committee model
as part of it
to decide tell people how did you come about becoming involved in
I
Andover?
Personally came there was just an exchange of emails and I saw Poet Laureate and I said I'd like to be on that committee mm-hmm. so I emailed someone and the end result was I ended up on the committee mm-hmm. and I was thrilled to be a part of it. I think that Andover in general I'm on the Andover Cultural Council uh-huh. so as a result of that I'm much more involved in what's going on culturally, and the people who are involved are very excited about making
very.
Culture That's alive in Andover.
Yep.
And so it was very exciting to be on the committee, but basically what we did was first we met and we decided what we thought the Poet Laureate of Andover should be doing and be a part of and what represents Poet Laureate dumb or whatever you want to call it.
It's hard to explain.
And
terms.
Then the chairman of our committee did some research and came up, as Karen just said, with an Arlington model, in other words, what they had done. So we went over all the possibilities. We met a number of times, went over all the possibilities. Okay, so what does Andover want? And then we made up a list of criteria and refined it and refined it and refined it and finally put it out there.
Uh-huh. For public knowledge.
Yep. Knowledge yep. and yep. possibility.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the end result was we had quite a few people, which
12.
We would have never known
12.
That
yep.
people even had an interest in Andover.
Yep.
So
yep.
it was
yep.
very, very exciting.
So it's going well in Andover.
Oh, we're very excited about it.
That's
so
great.
Then
it
what we did.
It was hard to choose
right.
at the end.
Oh. What we did as a committee is we put it out there. It was publicized in the newspaper. And after that, we had, as Karen said, about 12 applications that mm-hmm. came in. We met as a committee. We had all of the poetry in advance. We read it, looked it over. We selected individually which ones we wanted as individuals. Mm-hmm. And then from that process, we just kept narrowing it and narrowing it and narrowing it. We ended up with 3 possible candidates after
yeah.
a certain number of meetings.
Okay. Yeah.
And then at one of our final meetings, we said, okay, who's going to be the Poet Laureate of Andover?
Right, right.
And basically what
hard.
We did is we, you know, sort of tugged and pulled.
How it's picked, then.
Right, so yeah. we sort of tugged and pulled mm-hmm. with each other and went back and forth. Why not this person?
Yeah.
Why this person? And
a
so
lot
forth.
Of discussion.
Yeah.
A lot of discussion. Good discussion. Good
mm-hmm.
solid,
right.
mm-hmm. positive discussion as to what we thought, you know, especially because it was the first Poet Laureate.
Right.
In
yeah.
other
right.
words, that
yeah.
was a big a big deal because, mm-hmm. okay, this is a person that might, you know, this is a position that will repeat itself after any number of years.
Right.
And, you know, this is what we want it to look like. Mm-hmm. So we crafted, mm-hmm. you know, what Andover thought they might want, mm-hmm. basically.
Isn't that, and I think you've done a wonderful, wonderful job.
It?
Yes, you
now,
did.
Do yeah. you ladies meet at a certain time of the month every month or?
Mm-hmm. Not, once the poet laureate is chosen.
Yeah.
You don't need to have that many contacts with the committee
okay.
as far as, but you, these people do.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, they we like it. We like getting
right.
together.
Yeah.
So you did
exactly.
select someone. You've chosen.
Yes,
oh,
we have.
Yes, we have.
Yes, we have. And Linda. What's really exciting about it is I keep
it?
Thinking of that
oh, sure.
same
Linda.
Phrase that, you
tell
know,
them her Karen, name, Linda.
I can't remember.
Linda Haltmeyer.
Haltmeyer.
That's because she's got relatives in North Andover.
Oh, for God's
who
sakes,
are dear
yeah.
friends on Herrick Road.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
on Anne, her sister-in-law, and, well, they're both sisters-in-law.
Right.
And it's Anne and Susan. Anne, oh, what's her last name? I can't think of it right now. But and Susan Haltmeyer is
now
her
you
sister-in-law.
Sound like me.
Yeah.
Well, you know what?
Right, exactly.
What
exactly.
Really, you know what really comes up for me with respect to the poet laureate is that phrase that I used before that you came up with, being mm-hmm. a cheerleader for poetry. Mm-hmm. So, since this is our first endeavor in mm-hmm. Andover, it's going to be really exciting as a committee to sit down with Linda, and try to figure out, well, in what ways will she become this cheerleader
right.
for poetry?
They
right.
had
the
ideas before they came yeah.
right?
to it, but now we want to do
but
more.
Now we want to see what she wants to do and mm-hmm. what she will do and mm-hmm. you know what's feasible in the town. There will definitely be, from discussions, a connection with the Andover Cultural Council. There will be connections with music groups in Andover.
Schools
in Andover. So we don't know exactly how it's all going to play out.
Right.
We're going to check with Karen and mm-hmm. find out what mm-hmm. North Andover's done mm-hmm. over the years and other towns, mm-hmm. you know, to find out exactly what the Poet Laureate does mm-hmm. and sort of craft what our expectations will be.
Wow. That'll be interesting.
Yeah,
sure.
So it's going to be really, it's going to continue to
Linda
be exciting.
Linda has a lot of ideas.
She
really?
Does.
Linda has a lot of ideas.
Yeah.
She's written poetry for years.
That's a good thing.
Oh, yeah.
And
ideas.
Published.
Yes.
Published poetry.
Oh,
also.
Oh, yeah.
That's excellent.
Oh, yeah. People,
yeah.
Well, Helena's got her books.
Right.
She's got
I was
her
just
going to
ask Helena.
Yeah.
Helena.
Two.
How are you?
Oh, good. Well, I was going to talk a little bit about the North Andover Poet Laureate Committee. We have a very nice group of people. It's mm-hmm. co-chaired by Gail Henney, who's mm-hmm. a former Poet Laureate in
right.
North Andover, and Jill Barker
mm-hmm. from the library.
And
wonderful
Mary Ellen Osgood is on it. Mark Bohr.
One of my favorites.
And mm-hmm. We chose Ken and Nadine, and we kind of knew what we wanted to choose.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Really didn't have any other applicants this time. Mm-hmm. It's just, and they're Ken and Nadine. Delano, but they go by Kennedy, and for years, and they still do it sometimes, but they're semi-retired, they would go into schools and have workshops with kids. I think 4 or 5 children would work on one poem, and by the end of the week, they could present it.
Mm-hmm.
And they will sometimes do a performance of a poem and say, oh, well, we learned this from the kids.
Mm-hmm.
Recently, they've performed The Raven.
Oh, wow.
At a community reading in Lawrence,
yes.
Fantastic. And then The Highwaymen the other night.
Yes.
You know, you can just say a poem, and they'll just, there's a wonderful one called 15 that Ken likes to do on
okay,
his own.
Okay, I haven't seen that. I haven't seen
and,
that.
And they're really, and they'll recite their own poetry,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they'll suddenly just start, you know, and they move around the room, they jump up on chairs. Or,
they
very
get you excited.
And,
they get you excited.
Cheerleaders.
They're cheerleaders. They're
really?
Absolutely.
So they'll go into, and they have, you have them on your, they've been interviewed here on the Journal.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yes.
So mm-hmm. I guess that's available on maybe on YouTube. I'm
yes,
not sure
it is. It probably
I'm
is.
Correct.
Yep.
And they are going to work with the schools. They met with Jacqueline Woodson, who was here.
Oh, yeah.
And they did a
she's a National
workshop
Book Award winner. Jacqueline
with kids.
Woodson was here in November.
Right.
And
right.
Just excellent.
I know they have lots of ideas, and we will be in touch with them. I think we probably don't meet that much anymore, but we'll informally be in touch
well,
with them.
Well, when you have a pair like that
yeah.
who have been so busy for so many years, you don't need to do much.
Right. They kind of,
you're new and you've got what Andover has is a great cultural landscape.
Yeah.
With so many different organizations. And you tell them about the Scarecrow.
Oh, well, the Andover Cultural Council this year sponsored
participated in the, I think it was ACE, the Educational Committee.
Yes,
to
for
create
education.
the Committee for Education, mm-hmm. to promote poetry. You know, it was, we took up the theme, we went to them and we said, is it possible that the theme for this year might be poetry for the Scarecrow Festival that's been going on for a couple of years? And the end result was, they said yes, and then as the scarecrows appeared in town on the various lampposts.
They were wonderful.
They were,
so great.
It was real.
This is in Andover?
Yeah.
They've
been doing it for a couple
three, four years.
Yeah, a couple of years.
I have never heard of it
Yes,
before.
It's so cool. Just before,
it
you know, it's a couple weeks before Halloween.
So
and
special.
Different organizations create their scarecrows and put them up on the lampposts.
So we had. Main Street.
Wow, that would be interesting.
Oh, yeah.
See, not the end of it should do something like that.
No, but see, this is what we do. We learn from other. We wouldn't have been talking about this. Except for the poet laureate.
Right,
that's right.
Exactly.
That's what I'm saying. It wouldn't have happened.
Exactly.
So our cultural council did Emily Dickinson.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so we had her in costume, and mm-hmm. We had her poetry, some of her poetry, and a book of her poetry in her arm. It was really cool.
Oh, that's so
they were really,
really.
Yeah. And then what was really neat is when we went into town, like on Sunday morning, I was happened to be in town. I went around to all the different scarecrow just to see them because they were really exciting to see.
Yes.
But it was very exciting to see parents coming around with their children
and the reactions
to each one of the scarecrow, and especially to reading the poetry.
Yep.
Some of them had poetry. Right. Some of the children wrote poetry, mm-hmm. so it was very exciting. It was a fun event.
And the one for the Poet Laureate Selection Committee was Edgar Allan Poe.
Right.
Edgar Allan Poet.
Right. So we
That's
had
who he
right.
made, he yeah. was for the selection.
That's right.
Committee.
The
so
poet.
So they've already had an event for that.
Wow.
Right. So as the Poet Laureate Committee unfolded, and it was Scarecrow time, Scarecrow mm-hmm. creating time, mm-hmm. as Karen said. We all decided as a committee that it should be Edgar Allan Poe, and then a couple of us got together and we sort of just created
neat.
Edgar.
Wow. So neat.
It was really fun.
Now, these scarecrows, as people make these
scarecrows? Oh, yeah.
They give you.
Football players,
yeah. right.
I mean, you name
they
it.
Give you, yeah, they give you just a base. Like they give you a wooden base. Mm-hmm. They give you the straw, you know, some straw to mm-hmm. stuff it, and then you dress it, basically.
Wow.
So it was great fun.
And like whatever that. You want to dress it, it's
like
so
it.
Fun.
Cute idea.
And then for 2 weeks before Halloween, you drive up and down Andover, and that's what you see. It's really
And then
cool.
they're auctioned off. Don't forget
that's
that
right.
part. It's
oh,
a
they
fundraiser.
Do.
Yeah.
Oh,
a fundraiser.
Yeah, that's a
they
good
have
idea.
Made, they yes. have made
this is
thousands
eight, yeah, this
of
is
eight.
Fundraiser for
Andover.
What committee
right.
is it?
What
Andover
the Andover
Education.
Coalition for Education, Education is what it's called.
That's
it's
nice.
Really very
yep.
exciting.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's a wonderful
yeah, they
program.
Do have a lot of things in Andover.
They do.
Yep.
I'm
do.
Trying to build not the Andover up in a
They're
sort of,
be
a
more.
Of a way, you
exactly.
know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
But it's hard to do because you need volunteers. Just like here at the studio,
yeah.
we need volunteers,
mm-hmm.
and it's so
mm-hmm.
hard
mm-hmm.
to get volunteers.
Right.
And I don't understand why. If you enjoy doing something, it should be easy. You
mm-hmm.
know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like me, I enjoy doing a show like this. I just don't understand
a key,
why you can't get
A key
volunteers.
That I've found with all my work, I've been working with kids in North Andover since 1988.
Really?
And started the program with literature in 1995. And I've found that if you are getting a young family, when the children are just getting into the school,
mm-hmm.
you've got a good audience.
Mm-hmm.
If you wait until they're in middle school,
really?
High school, everybody's entrenched in their own
exactly.
set.
Yep.
routine.
You catch their
they're
interest
in their
they're
music,
younger.
They're in their sports, they're in
right.
their whatever.
Right.
But if you get them when they're brand new to the school, that's when you're going to find people who say, oh, this is exciting. My child
yeah.
would love to be involved in this. They could learn this and this and this.
Yeah.
It works.
Yeah.
It works.
I wondered if I could just mention about Ken and Nadine.
Sure can.
That they're also involved. Well, the two things. One, the one Tuesday a month, the fourth Tuesday, they have a open mic poetry reading at the Stevens Memorial Library
uh-huh.
in Andover. And you can get there at 6:30 to sign up to be a reader.
Yep.
You get 5 minutes. They have an hourglass to keep.
It's fun.
And
it's
you don't
fun.
Have to read. You can be in the audience.
You can just,
and
listen.
Just listen.
I'd like mm-hmm. to. When is that? Every
It's the fourth Tuesday
okay.
of every month.
Of every month. But you
mm-hmm.
can check with the library and check the
It's
website.
On the website.
And
right.
It's delightful. And you never know who's going to be there. But Ken and Nadine usually...
Oh, they got a good
very
mixture
good
of people, too. They
it's
come from all over.
It's definitely worth
Yeah, yeah,
I mean, it might
out.
Be something you'd want to film. Something. I don't right. know if they film it, but
I don't yeah, know if they Not could. The End of a Cam has ever done anything
I
like that.
I don't know, but it would be worth
that's
the
a
time.
Good, yeah, that's a good shot.
Because what they know a great many poets who are from the North Shore.
Right. They come from other
All
towns.
All over. Ipswich. Beverly, right. Hamilton, yeah. Wenham.
Danvers.
Just yeah. Gloucester, right. Rockport.
Yeah. yeah.
They all come.
Yeah.
I mean, not all the time.
Right, right.
But every once in a while, you're going to have a new person from Salem or Newburyport or Gloucester that you've never met before.
Exactly, yeah.
And that is fun.
But that would be a good segment on the journal, to put on the journal.
Yes,
I mean,
yes.
A shot from
oh,
that.
Yes. Definitely.
I think that would be very interesting.
Yes, it would be. It would be.
And then also similar, in the winter months, the second Tuesday of the month, at the Cafe Azteca in Lawrence, there's a poetry reading. That usually has featured readers. Followed by an open mic, and mm-hmm. Ken and Nadine are very involved in mm-hmm. that.
That's with the Robert Frost Foundation.
The connection to Lawrence is Robert Frost.
Excellent.
Yes.
Excellent.
Yes.
We're almost out of time. Real quick.
Right.
What about these books behind you?
I have these now. Poems to Read. Robert Pinsky was the Poet Laureate of America.
Uh-huh.
3 times in a row. No wow. one has yeah. ever been Poet wow. Laureate 3 times
really
in a row.
Look yeah. at that.
And yeah. he started Poems to Read in October of 1998 at the Boston Library.
And where's he from?
He's from Boston University.
Wow.
Boston University. And he has books out. This one on page 9 is my honoring of Ann Bradstreet, if you look oh. at page
nice.
9 of this
nice.
Book. But he has books, he has videos, he has TV show. It's amazing what he's done, and that's why he was involved for 3 times in a row, because they
right.
saw what he was starting,
right? Yep.
And they didn't want him to stop.
Mm-hmm. Didn't he start the Favorite Poem Project?
That's yeah, it. That's yeah. what
that's
it started
probably
as.
The most
and this
lasting
is Poems to Read is the first book.
Project. Yeah.
The Favorite Poems Project was what was done at the library.
Mm-hmm.
We copied that as the Frost Foundation. We are doing it. We're all 3 of us are members of the Frost Foundation from Lawrence.
That's excellent. Yeah.
And we have our community read once a year as our festival at the Lawrence High School. Is it the last Friday of October?
Yeah, it's
usually
Robert
the last
Frost
Friday
Day
of October.
Sort of mm-hmm. around there.
And yeah. It's wonderful. We have people from who are auto mechanics
right.
who come in and read their poetry.
Right.
Or they
wow,
read a
that's
favorite
excellent.
Poem. Either
favorite
one.
Poem, either okay. their own poetry
there's
or the favorite.
There's poets
really?
Of every vocation.
There are poets
really?
That are closet poets.
Wow,
right.
sure.
Don't
really.
Tell anybody they write it or they
really?
Love it.
What a shame, really.
And we've got to bring them out.
Okay, right. just real quick, the other
And the other ones, here. Maya Angelou I mentioned before, and then Bobby Kennedy, just because the Kennedy family was so involved
right.
with poetry.
Right.
And then the 3 centuries of American poetry, Ann Bradstreet is the first one who led that poem. Let me read one real, I'll give you one quick little poem.
I might just show this book too.
Oh, yes.
Just because to see, this was my husband's.
You can tell it's well loved.
Wow.
This is the anti-Kindle.
Of
this
Robert
is what
Frost.
Happens. Anyway.
And Robert wow. Frost. See, we've got Ann Bradstreet from North Andover, who's the first poet.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have John Greenleaf Whittier from Haverhill, who is the next poet in
yep.
line
yep.
as far as age.
Yep.
Then we have Harriet, he's from Haverhill. Yep. Harriet Beecher Stowe is buried in Andover.
Huh.
That's right.
And
mm-hmm.
she's at the Andover, Phillips Andover Academy, and
right.
she has the Stowe House in the Phillips Andover
yep.
land.
Yep.
And she's the third poet. And then the fourth one is Robert Frost from Lawrence.
Wow. Excellent.
Valley
I call
of the
it
poets.
The Valley of the Poets.
That's right. It's good.
That's why.
Okay, we're out of time. Sorry to say, because I know you have a lot more to talk about. In fact, if you still have more information to give us, we'll plan another show with you.
We'd love to do that. And
really, really interesting.
Yeah.
I didn't think it was going to be interesting, to be honest, but it was fantastic. It was great.
Everybody
I want to thank you ladies very much for coming on our first show here in the new year.
Thank you.
And you did a great job.
It's a good way to start. Next, we have to get the young people here.
Yes, definitely. We're going
to
try doing that.
We get the Junior Poet Laureate of North Andover High School.
Yep. Yep.
And he can bring people in.
That'll be great.
Yes.
Okay, well, thank you very much for tuning in. And thanks for the showing our show in the new year. Make sure you come and watch our other shows coming up. We'll try to do one once a month. And again, thank you for watching.